All right now. Come on, come on, come on. Hey. This is Narcissistic Abuse No More with your host, doctor and evangelist, K.L. Rich. We're here to help you and get what you feel in order to heal from the effects of narcissistic abuse. Hey, how y'all doing today? Come on now. Man, I am just loving this new intro. Come on, come on. Y'all send me some emails. Oh, my goodness. At narcabusenomore@gmail.com. narcabusenomore@gmail.com. Hi, this is your host. This is Narc Abuse No More with your host, Dr. and Evangelist K.L. Rich, where we're here to help you admit what you feel in order to heal from the effects of narcissistic abuse, because your feelings do matter. Yes, they do. But before we go on with today's podcast, I'd like to invite you to visit us on our website at www.narcabusenomore.org. Again, that website address is www.narcabusenomore.org. And on our website, you'll find valuable information regarding narcissism, relationships. And if you have missed any of these podcasts, all you have to do is go directly to the website and listen to us from there. Now, just to let you know, we're on every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 a.m. Central, and that is on SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Spreaker, Google Play, iTunes, CastBox, and Deezer. We're also on Amazon Audible, Rumble, Brighteon, and the Tube. That's right, we're on YouTube. And if you're following me on Facebook, you can also listen to the podcast from there, because now I am uploading onto Facebook. But just before we get into today's podcast, I want to just invite you to tune in on Friday's podcast. Lord willing, we're having a guest on Friday's podcast, Aisha Gilliam, who has just written this new book called Closing Doors for a Purpose. It's called Closing Doors for a Purpose. And we're going to just talk about some of the things that she had written in this book about her life and relationships and just things in general that she's gone through. And I believe that you will be inspired when you listen to this this interview that we're going to do on Friday. Again, that's with the author Aisha Gilliam, Closing Doors for a Purpose. And you can get this book on Amazon.com, Walmart, and I'm sure there's some other ones, Lulu.com. And we'll talk about if there's some other sites or locations that you can pick up this book. But again, it's called Closing Doors for a Purpose, and we will be interviewing the author, Aisha Gilliam, on Friday. So tune in to us on Friday, Lord willing. All right, what are we talking about today? We are talking about codependency. Codependency. What are some of the signs of codependency, and are you a codependent? Now, we know that narcissists love to play on people that they can use, abuse, misuse, and do all kind of little nasty little things to with their games that they play with other people. But sometimes you might be attracted to the narcissist because you are a codependent, all right? And we want to help you to recognize if you have signs of codependency. So what is codependency? Basically, when you're talking about codependency, you're talking about someone who often elevates the needs of other people above their own. And this is not, I'm not talking about selfishness or anything of that nature. It's in the unhealthy sense. Okay. So, if you are, I'm not going to say people pleaser, but this can lead you into people pleasing because you're always seeking to please others above your own or at the risk of your own happiness. I'm not talking about self-sacrifice because sometimes we, you know, if you're a person that would give your last or do for others, there's nothing wrong with that in the healthy sense, okay, in the healthy sense. But oftentimes when you are a codependent, it often attracts like a magnet people that are toxic, people that are abusive, people that are narcissistic. And so we want you to recognize that when you're dealing with codependency, those that are codependency sometimes have a fear of rejection. If I don't go the extra mile, or if I don't do what this person wants me to do or whatever, then this I'm going to be rejected. But let me just say this. If someone really cares for you, they're not going to have you doing things that will cause you to be diminished in the process. So we're going to talk more about that. So codependency is, again, it's a way of always prioritizing others above yourself. Okay. And this is in the unhealthy sense. Now, let me just say, oftentimes, if you're a parent and you have children, you will oftentimes put your children above your own needs. But let me just say this. I'm talking about in the unhealthy sense. All right. Where people can use you, people can abuse you, people can take you for granted, people will walk all over you if they recognize or see that you may have some codependent traits. Because let me just say this, when you're dealing with people that are all about themselves, such as narcissists are, they don't care about your feelings. They don't care about your needs. They don't care about the things that matter to you. They don't empathize with you. It's all about them. So you, if you are this codependent, then it's time to sit back. Take a breather and analyze the people that are around you, those users and abusers. And let me just say this before we get started with these signs, because there's some traits that you may want to recognize that might be within yourself. If you are a codependent, it is so important for you to get comfortable with the word no. No, 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 no. Let me. It makes me think when I used to do daycare and people, and when I had the kids of all ages, and you had the 2-year-olds, and one of the first words that babies learn is no. Okay, no, 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 or mine, mine, mine. Okay, so they have no problem with saying no. But then as you grow into adulthood or whatever, then sometimes those things change. But you have to put no in your vocabulary. It is okay to sometimes say no, this is not what's best for me. I have to look out for myself. And so codependent traits, it disconnects you from your own sense of needs, your own sense of self-worth, your own sense of wants, or you often put yourself in the back seat because you have this individual that you're always putting ahead of yourself. And that's how you know that oftentimes you might be in an unhealthy relationship when that person is not saying, you know what, let me change, reverse the roles and let me put you first for a change. But if you're always putting your spouse or this person that you're dating or someone, this friendship or whatever it is, if you're always putting their needs above your own, but that person is never thinking about you, then you may be a codependent. And let me just say this, because people will use you. And it was this lady I used to know years ago that she used to say, you teach people how to treat you by what you allow them to do to you. And that saying is so true. We teach a pattern of behavior, even when it comes to others. What you allow them to do, they will continue to do because they feel like they have that stamp of approval. So we're gonna go into what the signs that you may be a codependent. Now, according to 2018 research review, codependents normally have four general themes. They're self-sacrificing, number one. They have a tendency to over-focus on others. They have a need to control whatever may fuel the conflict, and they have difficulty recognizing and expressing their emotions. And I want to just deal with these first four. Self-sacrifice. Now, as Christians, we learn to sacrifice for others, but there is a unhealthy sense when you are self-sacrificing yourself to the point of even being in a relationship where you know this relationship is unhealthy, but you're self-sacrificing because you're saying, well, I need to stay in this, even though this person is abusing me, misusing me, belittling me, demeaning me, devaluing me, all these things, but I need to stay in this relationship because, after all, they have gone through X, Y, and Z. And let me just say this. Now, I've often said this on this podcast, and I'm going to say it again, is that just because someone has been abused themselves does not give them the right to abuse you. So when you're self-sacrificing and saying, well, I have to stay in this mess because of the mess that they have been in, that is unhealthy. Okay, so that's a sign of codependency. Number two is a tendency to focus, over-focus on others. All right, so you have to have some balance. And if you are too focused on others at the extent of you're lacking yourself, then you're not in a balanced relationship. Let me use an example. Whenever you fly, and I haven't flown in years, I think the last time I took a flight was in 2009. But whenever you fly, one of the things that the stewardess or stewards will tell you is to put your mask on first. If there's some trouble, some turbulence, and those masks come down, they tell you to put your mask on first, so then you can help the person next to you put theirs on. But if you pass out, and while you're trying to help somebody else, then you're no good to that individual or anybody else. So there are times when you have to focus on you. You have to give yourself that self-care, okay? Give yourself some love. Number three, the need to control. Let me just say this, and I'm not talking about in the sense of narcissism. I'm talking about in the sense of you feel like I have to put out everyone's fire. So everyone comes to you with their problems. You feel like, okay, I got to help this one with that one, help that one with this one, and help them. You can't be an octopus, okay? You got your arms in too many pots, too many cookie jars, and you're trying to put out everyone's fire, trying to control every situation, but you're only one individual. So it is so important to recognize that you cannot do or be everything to everybody. Number four, difficulty recognizing and expressing emotions. And you might say, because you're so used to putting yourself in the background, you're not coming in touch with your own emotions, how it's making you feel, and the things that are important to you, because you're putting it in the background. So you're having difficulty saying, well, this hurts, or no to this, or I can't do this, or whatever case may be. So these are the top four that you need to recognize when it comes to being a codependent. I'd like to give you a website where you can get this valuable information at psychcentral.com, psychcentral.com, and you can get look up codependency on this website. Now, One of the things that is a common sign when you're talking about codependency is a codependent often has the need to have the approval of other people. And this is what narcissists thrive on. They love to match themselves with codependents because the narcissist has the need for control and the need for attention and the need for admiration. And then the codependent also has a need for approval from someone else. So even though this person may not be the healthiest for you, you're still seeking their approval. It could be a parent. It could be a spouse. It could be a boss. It could be a friend or enemy, a frenemy, or whatever the case may be. And you're seeking the approval of others. When you are confident in yourself, who God has made you to be, you do not have to have the approval of everybody, because guess what? You're not going to get it anyway. So you're working to try to get everyone to like you, everyone to be pleased with you, everyone to be happy with you, everyone to celebrate you, everyone to appreciate you. Stop, hold up, wait a minute. It's not going to happen. Because there's going to always be someone who complains, someone who doesn't like it, and you will run yourself bonkers, cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, that in trying to get the approval of everybody. You can't. It doesn't work. That's not life. It doesn't happen that way. And if you're basing your feelings about yourself on what other people say, think, or their approval of you, then you're going to be greatly disappointed, which you probably have if you're a codependent, because guess what? Everybody's not going to approve of you. Number two, your self-worth that depends on what others think about you. So you put your self-esteem, your sense of worth on what someone else says about you. If someone says that you're not good enough, then you feel I'm not good enough. If someone says that I'm not attractive enough. If someone says I'm not thin enough, I'm not thin enough. If someone says I'm not intelligent enough, I'm not intelligent enough. Let me just say this. If I had based my life on what other people say, because, you know, it's easy to do that, where you have people, you're not pretty, you're not this, you're not that, or whatever case may be, you're not smart, if you base it on that, then you're going to really be low on that self-esteem pole. You're going to always view yourself through the eyes of someone else. And who are they to judge and say who you or who God created you to be? Okay. So if you know that you are, you know, you're trying to be a good person, you're trying to be who God called you to be, you're trying to live life and everything, well, who is someone to give you a price tag on what your self-worth should be? You have to take yourself off of the clearance rack. Come on now, and know that you are full price. Actually, you're priceless, just like that MasterCard commercial that used to come on. You're priceless. All right. There's not enough money in the world that can pay for who I am. Okay. I am above value. As I always quote the psalmist, I am fearfully and I am wonderfully made. And I know that full well. And the one who did pay the price for me was Jesus. Okay. He paid the ultimate price for me. So therefore, no one can match that. Come on now. No one can match that. You have to know your worth, because if you allow other people to determine your worth, then guess what? You will not feel worthy of anything at all. Number three, you may have a habit of taking on more than what you can really handle. This is part of the people pleasing. Someone say, can you do this? Can you do that? This person asking, that person asking. And you know it's really more than what you should really take on. But because you don't want to say no, because you have a problem saying no to people, then you say, okay, I'll do it. I'll do it. Yes, 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 I'll do it. And then you wind up being burned out, drained out. Come on now. And you wind up wondering, okay, well, why am I stressed? Why am I having anxiety? Why am I having panic? Why am I having worry? Why am I blood pressure up? And all these things, because your body is letting you know you're taking on too much. You have to slow down. And sometimes you just have to say no. And well, narcissists, when you tell narcissists that, you know what, no, I can't do that. When you say no to them, will they like it? Of course not. They're narcissists. Okay. So then you have to have the mindset, sorry, who cares? All right. So you have to think about you. If you don't prioritize your feelings, then no one else will. You have to be able to say no, because again, people will use you and abuse you and then call it a day and keep going on about their merry own way while you're broken, while you're stressed out, while you're having issues, emotional issues based upon you trying to be everything to everybody. Now, there's a scripture in the Bible where Paul was saying that he was everything to everyone, but that wasn't in the unhealthy sense. That was, you know, for those who he need to be a minister to, he ministered to those who need to be encouraged to, he encouraged. And so you want to make sure that you are doing it in a healthy sense about when it comes to relationships and when it comes to life, you have to have balance. All right, we're going to take a quick break. And we'll be back in just a moment.
I dedicate this song to recession, depression, and unemployment. This song's for you.
Today's a new day, but there is no sunshine. Nothing but clouds, and it's dark in my heart. Today's a new day, but where are my blue skies? Where is the love and the joy that you promised me? Tell me it's alright.
I'll be honest with you.
I almost gave up, but a power that I can't explain fell from heaven like a shower.
When I think how much better I'm gonna be when this is over.
Today's a new day, but there is no sunshine. Nothing but clouds, and it's dark in my heart, and it feels like a cold night.
It ain't easy, bud.
Today's a new day, but tell me, where are my blue skies?
Where is that love, y'all?
Where is the love and the joy that you promised me? Tell me it's alright.
The truth is,
I almost gave up.
Power, y'all.
Fell from heaven like a shower down.
Now, I know we've been hurt, y'all, but still.
I smile.
Come on.
Even though I hurt, see, I smile.
Y'all feel that?
I know God is working, so I smile. Even though I've been here for a while.
Still.
I smile.
Hallelujah.
Smile. It's so hard to look up when you've been down. Sure would hate to see you give up now.
Cause people. Whatever you're in right now.
Smile, smile for me.
Smile.
Can you just smile for me?
And my people say,
oh, 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 you look so much better when you're, oh, oh, oh.
Remember,
you look so much better when you smile.
Come on.
I almost gave up.
I almost gave up. But
that
Holy Ghost power, y'all.
Fell from heaven. Like
came down from heaven.
Down.
Hardships, difficulties,
right now.
Tears, storms.
Hallelujah.
It's so hard to look up when you've been down.
I know it's hard right now.
Sure would hate to see you give up now.
Because you're a winner.
You look so much better when you smile.
You look better.
So smile.
You to be happy, but then you gotta have something happening. I want you to have joy, cause can't nobody take that from you. I see you smiling.
I smile. I smile. Come on, y'all. All right. Don't let nobody take your joy. I smile. That's by Kirk Franklin. All right. So we're still talking about codependency. Number four, you have a tendency to apologize or take blame in order to keep the peace. Now, one thing for us, you know, us that are Christians, we know that the Bible calls for us to be ministers of reconciliation. And so sometimes in order to make peace, to keep peace, you will just say, you know what, I'm sorry. And for us as Christians, that's a part of us being humble and being, and taking on the character of Christ, humility. However, there is another side of that too when it comes to those that are abusive narcissists, and they always want you to take the blame for their bad behavior. They never take responsibility for their actions. So therefore, you always find yourself, I'm sorry. And this is in an abusive relationship because you're walking on eggshells trying not to set that person off. And so you say, well, I'm just going to say I'm sorry because I don't want them to get mad. I don't want them to go into their narcissistic rage. I don't want them to be angry. I don't want to fight. And so therefore, I'm sorry. That is not healthy. If you're always the one that's apologizing, if you're always the one that's taking the blame for whatever went wrong in the relationship, whatever the case may be, then that is not a healthy relationship. So therefore, this is a sign of codependency when you feel as if I always have to be the one to say I'm sorry or I'm wrong or take the blame, and that other individual never takes responsibility for what they have done. Number five. You have a pattern of avoiding conflict. Again, you do anything that you can to walk on eggshells because you don't want any conflict. And let me just say that some people are just difficult people to get along with. And you have to recognize that some people just got some issues that they love drama. They will make an argument out of anything. And so you try to walk on eggshells around them. But let me just say this. If you are around someone that is constantly causing conflict and you are trying your best to avoid it, but it's like nothing that you do can, there's always something, then the issue is not you, it's that individual. So you have to decide, okay, is this person one that I should spend a lot of time with, that I should have in my inner circle, or I need to distance myself, or even sometimes you have to cut the relationship off altogether because that person is just so toxic that it's always a conflict. Number six, you have a tendency to minimize or ignore your own desires. So when you're in an unhealthy relationship, the narcissist, the toxic individual, will always have you feeling like you have to take a back seat to them. So, for example, you may want to go to school, but then they'll find some reason why you shouldn't, because at the end of the day, they don't want to see you move further along in life or move ahead. Or even if you marry, you will see, if you're married to a narcissist, you will see them try to sabotage you in the relationship to keep you from progressing because they they don't want you to achieve whatever. And you have those that are haters that when you do achieve it, they will find a way to make you feel as if you didn't earn it, as if you don't deserve it, as if you didn't work for it. And that's their way of, it's a sign of their jealousy and their envy of what you have achieved. When you're in a relationship, it should be where both parties support the other person's dream and vision, because when one succeeds, it's for the both of you. However, when you're in a relationship with someone that is insecure, then you're dealing with someone that's going to always be your competitor. Not that you're competing with them, but they're competing with you. And there's always going to be a conflict. And so therefore you might find yourself ignoring the things that you want to do in hopes of not trying to, bring rage out of the other person or cause them to feel insufficient, but it's not you why they feel that way. That's their own inner demons. Number 7. You may see that you have an excessive concern about one's habits, your loved one's habits or behaviors. If you're overly concerned about, for example, you might be married and the person drinks too much. And it's natural to be concerned about that person drinking. However, that person has to want to stop. You can't make someone do anything. And so in this codependent behavior, you also have to be careful that you're not playing the role of the controller, because we can't make someone do something. We can talk to them. We can try to bring them to the light if we can. But ultimately, they have to make that decision themselves. So you can't control someone else's habits or behaviors. They have to make a conscious choice that, you know what, this is something that I need to change and this is something that I want to change. Number 8. You have a habit of making decisions for others or trying to manage loved ones. You as a codependent, you might feel like, okay, I got to make sure I make this decision, that decision. You're trying to handle everything. Again, when you're dealing with adults, now you might be able to micromanage children, but you shouldn't have to micromanage adults. Okay, your children, you say, okay, you need to go get your clothes for school. You need to go fix your lunch. You need to do this. That. You expect to micromanage children, but not adults, not adults. So therefore, this is something that you might be experiencing, is having a habit of making decisions for others when they should be making those decisions for themselves. Number 9. A mood that reflects how others feel rather than your own emotions. You might find yourself, you might be happy. And then the other person that's toxic, abusive, or whatever, they might not be happy. So therefore, you might minimize your happiness, your joy, just so you don't be over joyful because the other person is in a bad mood. That is not a healthy relationship. On the last podcast or a podcast before that, I mentioned a friend that I used to have that was, you could tell she was in an abusive relationship because normally she would be in a social butterfly. But then when the abusive spouse came around, then she would shut all the way down and go into a cocoon where she wasn't laughing. She wasn't smiling. She would get quiet. And you could tell that change in her whenever this abusive spouse would come around. She couldn't be herself. So anyone that causes you to change your mood because of their mood, then that isn't healthy. And that can be a sign that you may have codependency. Number 10, there's guilt or anxiety when you do something for yourself. Sometimes you have to do things, you know, whether it's go buy a pair of shoes or whether it's go to a spa or whether it's taking a walk. or going to a bookstore just to clear your head and relax. But what happens is when you're with someone that is narcissistic, they will make you feel guilty just because you do something for yourself. You may like the garden, but the narcissist will find something wrong with whatever you do for yourself. They will make you feel selfish. They will make you feel like you're not giving them enough time. You're not giving them enough attention. And so therefore you will feel guilty just because you have taken some time for yourself. That is unhealthy. That means that you're dealing with someone unhealthy. And then you have to also say to yourself, you know what? I deserve this time. I deserve to do something for myself. And you deserve to do it being guilt-free. If that person doesn't appreciate that or value that, then that's their problem. That's their issue. But in order to have a healthy state of, a healthy emotional balance, you have to give yourself some self-care. All right, we're going to take another quick break and we'll be back in just a moment. And that is Count On Me by the late Whitney Houston and CeCe Winans. All right, so number 11, doing things you really don't want to do simply to make others happy. And that is a sign of codependency. Well, you know what? I don't want to do A, B, and C, but I'm going to do it just so I can make other people happy. Again, we oftentimes we will do that just as human beings. However, when you're doing it in an unhealthy sense, so therefore, when you're going overboard with it, when you're doing something for other people and then they never show any appreciation, they never say thank you, they is almost like an entitlement. Okay, when you're dealing with narcissists, they feel like they're entitled. So sometimes you have to say no. Number 12. Idealizing partners or other loved ones, often to the point of maintaining relationships that leave you unfulfilled. If you're in a relationship and you feel like you're always in a deficit, then something is wrong. You're making this relationship to be something of a fairy tale that it is not. It's actually a horror story. You might find yourself in a twilight zone, in the outer limits, okay? So you don't want to idealize that the relationship is something that it is not. If you're married to someone and that relationship is not going in the direction that you want it to go to, go in the direction that you want it to go in, then you need to talk to that person, possibly get some counseling, reevaluate that relationship and see, okay, what is it, what changes that needs to be made so that you will not be in an abusive, toxic relationship. Last but not least, overwhelming fear of rejection or abandonment. If you are holding on so close to this person because you feel like they're going to abandon you, they're going to reject you, well, guess what? You might not be in the healthiest of relationships anyway. A person that really cares for you is not just going to abandon you. They're not going to reject you. But the thing is, you have to know that you are worthy yourself of having wholesome relationships. Because let me say, some of these relationships need to be abandoned. Some of them need to be rejected. Why? Because they are toxic. They're abusive. They are unhealthy. So you don't want to be a magnet for any narcissist. You want to make sure that you stay, be able to say, hey, this is what I need in the relationship. Get support if you're struggling with telling or saying what you need. Make sure that you feel safe, that you can express your needs. And if you're with someone that you cannot tell them how you feel, or they don't understand, or they don't want to understand, then guess what? You're not in a healthy relationship. Another thing is, you have to let others know that when they're asking too much of you. You have to be able to set those healthy boundaries in order to be healthy yourself, in order to be confident in your own decisions, in order to be emotionally stable. This is so important when it comes to codependency. And there's quite a few things that could have led to you being a codependent. You could have been physically, emotionally, or sexually abused. You may have experienced being ignored by your parent. You may have had a parent that was narcissistic or had borderline personality disorder or some other things that may have caused you to be afraid. You may have had someone abandon you and then it caused you to hang on to a relationship because you've been abandoned before. But the thing is that if you recognize that you are a codependent, then guess what? There's something you can do. You can talk to someone. You can get counseling. You can get the help that you need in order to be able to, be that independent, not codependent, but independent person. And when I talk about independence, I'm not talking about apart from Christ, for those of us who are Christians and believers in the Lord, all right? But I'm talking about just independent away from being in a toxic relationship. And that is so important for you to be able to be the best person that God has called for you to be. All right, we are up out of here. I pray that today's podcast has been a blessing to you and that you will know your feelings They do matter. This is Dr. K.L. Rich with Narc Abuse No More. Until next time.